I'm here with Dr. Brandon Beaber, author of the book, Resilience in the Face of Multiple Sclerosis, and an MS specialist at California's Kaiser Permanente Healthcare Consortium. He wrote the Roxanne MS parody on this channel, and his YouTube channel about life with multiple sclerosis has over 9,000 subscribers. So best believe he is out here. Today, we're going to go in about COVID and MS, because you know the good doctor has all the zeros and ones about the novel virus and how it relates to MS. And we're going to get into all that right now. Thank you for being here on this program, sir. I'm taking you away from your 9,000 subs and all of your charts and nerdings. Come on, man. Thank you.
No problem. Plenty of time to get, you know, I know people will appreciate it, I hope.
Absolutely. No, the idea that people just make content for folks with multiple sclerosis, whether it's from the patient's point of view, whether it's from the physician's point of view, we all sort of have our own facets of this jewel that, you know, I guess is not that much of a jewel, but the metaphor works. We all come from different angles about this multiple sclerosis thing. And whenever we find the chance to sort of come together, it's really brilliant, man. And so that's what I'm saying. Thank you for being in this space. Like, really, thank you.
No problem. And if anyone has suggestions for videos, I'm always looking out. You could post them in the comments below as well.
Look at that. He's a man of the people, y'all. All right. So look, we're going to talk about COVID and MS today, right? So you do have any interesting data or any interesting numbers? Like, because I know a lot of people are scared. A lot of people are like, can I get the vaccine? Well, can I get the vaccine with my specific DMT? Or how long should I wait? Like all of that stuff. Do you have any sort of insight into that? Oh, but first, talk to your doctor. This is not medical advice. Believe that. Insight into how folk can begin to shape their own research that they're doing right now.
Well, definitely there's a lot of concern with a lot of these medications that are immunosuppressants. Mm. So we don't think that multiple sclerosis itself increases the risk of COVID-19. You know, there's no specific evidence that having MS makes you more susceptible, right. But some of the medications are immunosuppressants and they can both increase your risk in two ways. One, by weakening your immune system directly, and also by reducing the efficacy of the vaccines. So for some of the medications like glatiramer or acetate, Copaxone or Glatopa, and beta interferons like beta-seron, Xtavia, Rebif, and Avonex, they're not really immunosuppressants, so they don't seem to increase the risk of COVID. In fact, there's some studies suggesting people taking beta interferons have a decreased risk for whatever reason. Maybe there's some antiviral properties of those medications. Whoa. You know, for some of the medications like Aubagio and Tecfidera, pills for MS, there doesn't really seem to be a dramatically increased risk, even though in theory these medications weaken the immune system. In practice, it doesn't seem to be a greatly increased risk.
Right.
Now, there was a recent study published by the National Health Service. They have really good data just because essentially they have access to the whole country's medical records in England. And they found that there was a big difference in the pre-vaccination period and in the post-vaccination period of people taking the medications Gilenya and Ocrevus. You know, so Gilenya is a pill for MS, and it's in a class of medications called S1P receptor modulators.
Yep.
It's similar to some other medications such as Zeposia and Mayzent. And they found that in the post-vaccination period, supposedly people taking Gilenya were at a 40% greater risk. Mm. So that kind of suggests that the vaccine is not as effective in people taking those medications.
Absolutely.
And, you know, the data was on Gilenya, but I suspect it's very similar for the other medications.
Yeah.
For Ocrevus, there was an 80% greater risk. So
right.
Ocrevus and other similar medications such as rituximab and, you know, the Kesimpta, the subcutaneous formulation.
They knock out all your B cells, man. Like a third of your immune system is like gone. So it doesn't eat away at your brain and your spine. So yeah, that leaves you more susceptible to viruses. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, and basically they found that the vaccines essentially aren't as effective because that group didn't seem to be at very high risk prior to vaccination relative to the general population. But after vaccinations were widely available, they were somehow significantly more susceptible. Now, I do think the vaccines are effective in people taking these medications, because even if you have no B cells, you still have T cells. And it's really hard to measure a T cell response to infections, but it definitely exists. It's just not a convenient biomarker. So you should definitely get the vaccine and get the booster. In fact, you should especially get the booster if you're taking an immunosuppressant. One tip, at least for people in the United States in some areas, if you're taking an immunosuppressant and you're going to get the booster, probably the most effective vaccine is the Moderna vaccine. And you could actually ask for the full dose of the Moderna vaccine. The normal booster is a half dose, but you could just tell them, I'm immunosuppressed, I want the full dose. And generally speaking, they would give it to you.
But why is it more effective, one versus the other? Is it mRNA versus the, I don't even know what the other one does.
Well, so the Moderna and Pfizer vaccines contain messenger RNA, and they basically cause your own cells to produce the spike protein so that you develop an immune response.
Right.
It turns out Moderna is effectively a higher dose than Pfizer, so it's stronger. Now, it may have greater risk for certain populations. For instance, there's a small risk of pericarditis, myocarditis, inflammation around the heart, primarily occurring in young men aged 12 to 25. You know, so in that population, you know, maybe people should be more conservative. But, you know, presuming someone is a little older, a little higher risk, I think the full dose Moderna as a booster makes a lot of sense.
Indeed.
Now, the other vaccine, the Johnson & Johnson, that's not an mRNA vaccine, that does seem to be less effective overall. So for someone who's higher risk, I would tend to advise going with the mRNA vaccines.
Right. So it's to me, my whole brain is just sort of numb with all this, because you have to have your own set of things when you have MS. Like, you have your own, you know, this is what I do, this is what I eat, this is how I, you know, live and work and such. And then you add the novel virus on top. And in some ways, it's like the world is catching up with you. Because you have been quarantining your dang self, you know, just because of MS for quite some time. And now the world is taking the amount of precautions that you take every day. So it's just a weird space to be in. And having some vaccines giving you more of a leg up on it, and then having some therapies giving you a leg up with it, and some therapies kind of giving you like a leg down with it. It's sort of a strange space to be in, and everybody just kind of wants to know if they're going to be okay, like if they're going to be safe, you know?
Yeah, and I'm not trying to promote any kind of excessive fear. Like, just to tell you my own experiences, certainly like earlier in the pandemic, you know, prior to vaccines being available, I've had, you know, a lot of patients get sick. I've had patients die. You know, we do the consults on like neurological complications of COVID and things like that. But, you know, I probably have like over 1,000 patients with MS. And I have four patients who were vaccinated, received two doses of the mRNA vaccines, and still got hospitalized with COVID. They all recovered, so no one died. But I have four vaccinated patients who got COVID. Wow. All four of those were taking a B-cell depleting medication, and they had received the medication prior to getting the vaccine. So it kind of makes sense that the vaccine wasn't as effective. I've had zero patients who are not immunosuppressed get hospitalized with COVID, with MS. You know, I've had other patients with other diseases and everything like that who are vaccinated. And I've had zero patients who received the booster who were hospitalized for COVID-19, regardless of their other medical conditions, age, type of immunosuppressants they take. You know, so I've had a lot of patients with some pretty significant risk factors, and almost all of them had mild illness. So, you know, if you're out there and you're 30 years old and generally healthy, but you take Ocrevus or Gilenya and you're vaccinated, particularly if you had the booster, I don't think you need to be excessively worried.
Absolutely. Like, one of the biggest questions people have is, can MS patients take the COVID-19 vaccine? And it seems to be that the answer is a resounding yes, get the vaccine.
Yeah, the answer is yes. I mean, there's no evidence that the vaccine worsens the course of MS. There are a few like small observational studies showing that, you know, the rate of relapses after vaccination is kind of the same as the background rate of relapses. You know, I have like over 1,000 patients with MS. I haven't seen any worsening of disease. Now, some people, they get bad side effects with the vaccine, like fever. And just in general with MS, if you have any illness or fever, you can kind of have worsening symptoms for a little while. So that could definitely happen, but it's usually pretty brief.
Yeah, if it's too hot in the kitchen, you know, you don't do so well if you have MS. You know what I mean? The idea of I'm just trying to even find the words for this, because I'm looking at my list here. It's like, can patients take the vaccine? Yes, they can. And yes, they should. Okay. Does multiple sclerosis increase COVID risk? I'm just kind of like, I don't think so, but that doesn't even seem to sort of compute in my brain, but people ask this question. So like, can having MS increase your risk for getting COVID?
On its own, we don't think it increases the risk, but with some of these disease modifying therapies, yes. You know, a lot of the studies looking at MS and COVID show that the risk factors for bad COVID are kind of similar to the general population. Like if you're older, if you have more other medical conditions, there's also some evidence that if you're more disabled, like an older person that has significant disability, which is not everyone with MS, but certainly some people, they are a little bit higher risk.
Got it. Got it. And one of the other more pressing questions that I see out here is, can COVID cause MS? And I do know that there's long COVID, and that having COVID kind of might trigger some other things in you once you are done done with the virus itself. Have you seen anything about that as well?
Well, so long COVID, or what some people call like post-viral syndrome, is definitely a real thing. There's some people who develop this, like chronic fatigue or instability of the heart rate, something known as POTS, or postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome.
Yep.
You know, I've seen some other weird things like chronic headaches after getting COVID. I don't necessarily think it's specific to COVID. This could be associated with any virus, but there are just a lot of people getting COVID infection right now. So that's why we're seeing a lot of this. I'm not convinced it increases the risk of MS in general. There are some case reports of people who got MS slightly after getting COVID, but you know, we really haven't seen an overall increase in the risk of MS this year. So I'm not so convinced of that. That could be just a coincidental thing.
Yeah, the idea that you, not only are you a neurologist, you're an MS specialist, you also have a 4,000 people that are glued to their devices because they know that you are going to put out a video every week concerning something that they would like to, some information that they would like to know, some insight into their disease. Man, it's so special. Why? And it's part of the reason why I want you in the space, part of the reason why I'm honored to have you here in the space, and an extension of like, yo, this dude, he cares for people with multiple sclerosis. He write books for them. He wrote a song for them. And then he got DW to do a video with like 10 other people with MS because he cares about folk with MS, and he does the work. Whenever you sort of meet someone where they are and you are not in a good space, but they meet you in that not good space and enthusiastically say, come on, let's go. Let's take care of this together. It really is something special. And that's part of what you're giving to folk that watch your content, or the watchers channel, man, really.
It really means a lot to me to hear you say that, Damien.
It's true. I can only say the truth, man. have you seen any other sort of like numbers or charts or things that make your doctor brain go, you know, I talk about this on my channel. It'd be interesting for DW's people to know about these sorts of things.
Well, so a couple of things about Omicron. You know, obviously Omicron is more contagious. It has some element of immune escape, but the kind of good news about it is that it's less virulent. So there was a study in South Africa that the rate of hospitalization may have actually been about 80% less compared to Delta in the same country. Whoa. Now, you know, I made some posts on Twitter, which retrospectively may be a little bit embarrassing, kind of downplaying Omicron somewhat. You know, the reality seems to be in the United States, people are a little bit older on average, more medical comorbidities. We are seeing a significant rise in hospitalization. So it's no joke, but the rate of hospitalization and the rate of death definitely seems to be lower than with Delta. And that seems to be like a real phenomenon, not just because more people are vaccinated. And so, you know, maybe we're seeing some evolution of the virus to become more contagious, to kind of survive, but become less aggressive and cause less lung disease on the average.
Look, if there's Omicron, there's Delta, like there's just so many different, like, I'm just hoping that there's not Phi Beta Kappa Omicron COVID, you know, in by next Christmas.
Like, there that's probably the will thing. Be, but, you know, hopefully they're not that severe, you know.
No, it's... The idea that folk have to deal with not only themselves internally, but also manage the world out there and manage the world's taking to a belief in the virus, or a belief that the virus isn't that bad, or that it's a government thing. Like, it doesn't matter what you yourself individually think or believe, whatever I may judge that to be. The fact is, something's going around, bro. And take care of yourself so that you can take care of me, so that we can take care of each other. No, that's not really a sentiment. That is not the American way, so to speak. You know, it's all, we have a individualistic sort of a thing. And when a sickness, a virus comes around, it really helps, it highlights the need for community, the need for everyone to be on the same page. And a lot of times that just doesn't happen. Not just in America, like abroad, like plenty people in plenty places are like, I'm not doing that, you know?
Yeah, you know, it is a grind. I mean, for sure, we're all tired of this, but definitely, you know, if you do have symptoms, get tested and quarantined, because it's everywhere right now. It's hard to avoid. It may be very difficult to avoid. The best thing you can do is really get the vaccine and the booster. That's your number one thing. You know, one thing I would say to people who are taking an immunosuppressant is, you know, most of the time COVID infection is mild, and almost always it starts off as mild. And because of that, people don't really seek treatment or take it seriously. Right. You know, there are a couple problems with that. One is like the public health aspect, where people don't bother to get tested and then they're spreading it around. And we know most of the spreading is early on, like right before you get symptoms and right after you get symptoms. So it's really important to quarantine and test right away, you know. And of course, if you test negative, you can end the quarantine. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is that a lot of the treatments for COVID, which have advanced significantly, you know, they're really effective primarily in the first week. You know, because with COVID, there's sort of a viral replication phase. And later on, if you're unlucky enough to have severe illness, there can be an inflammatory phase. Right. And it can cause this acute respiratory distress syndrome and lung infection. But it's kind of too late for a lot of these interventions at that point, at this point. Now, listen, if you're healthy, you know, young, 20 years old, rip six pack, whatever, don't take any immunosuppressants. If you get COVID, just stay home and rest in quarantine. But if you have risk factors, like you're taking an immunosuppressant, you should at least ask about treatments. You know, for example, one new treatment that recently got approved is Paxlovid, which in a randomized trial was 89% effective at preventing hospitalization or death. That's really effective, but it has to be given early. Unfortunately, it's in really short supply, so you might be not be able to get it. That's just the practical reality. You know, you could at least inquire about monoclonal antibodies or Paxlovid or molnupiravir or remdesivir or one of the other treatments. One other thing that I could mention, a lot of the monoclonal antibodies don't actually work for Omicron, but I'm told that sotrovimab, a monoclonal antibody, is effective against Omicron. And at this point, you know, within Kaiser Permanente, we're seeing over 90% Omicron. So we would just presume that you have Omicron and not even bother with any of the other treatments.
Wow. Extra. Read all about it. We have more multisyllabic things on terms on this channel than I didn't even know was out here. So thank you, Dr. Beaver. No, I appreciate you coming into this space, and thank you for giving us some of your time and your insight about this whole novel virus thing that's not so novel the second year in, you know?
Not at all, but hopefully, you know, in 6 months, there'll be low levels and life will be normal, and 2022 will be a great year.
Where can all the cool kids who are watching this right now find you? Where can people find you out here?
Feel free to check out my Twitter. I post about MS research, or my YouTube channel. If, like I said, if you have a suggestion for a video, you can go ahead and post it in this video. I will check out the comments.
Look, he's a man of the people, y'all. Okay. I'm bringing you the most illustrious guest. I'm like Jesus and Mero. Okay. No. Thank you, Dr. Beaver. And thank you for joining us here. And I'm going to see you on a whole nother program, a whole nother time. So keep light.
Happy New Year, everyone.